Hello everyone. Thank you for joining us for our webinar this evening about keeping your trees healthy. We're going to be talking about insects and diseases tonight. My name is August Hoppe. I'm the president of Hoppe Tree Service. And with us today is Brad Hill. He's our plant healthcare manager. Brad, do you want to tell us a little bit about what you do, what your role is at our company?
Sure. Yeah, I run the plant healthcare department and I have been here since 2010. Seen a lot of changes and excited to continue those changes this upcoming season. We've got some exciting stuff in store.
We do. We've been taking a real look, good close look at our plant healthcare programs and the insects and diseases we're treating and the way we are going about our business. And one thing that's going to be new that we're launching this year is really an official organic plant healthcare program that's going to be an offering for people. We still have a lot of our conventional materials and products that we're using, but we've realized that there's a need that some people have sensitivities to chemicals. And if we can find different products that we can use that are just as effective and less, I guess, how would you describe it, Brad? The program?
Just a little, safer on the applicators, the homeowners. It's just a safer option for controlling some of the insect and diseases that we come across.
Yes, a lot less harsh products and things that are going to not interact poorly with beneficial insects. So that's kind of the direction we're heading with our plant healthcare program, and we're really excited about it. And we're going to talk a little bit more about it as we go through our presentation today. So we do have a slideshow, so we're going to start that slideshow in a second here and kind of go through the basics of keeping your trees healthy and what we can do to help you do that. So I'm going to start sharing. And so pest and disease control in our urban forest. So our urban forest is where we live and breathe and do our work. So it's definitely what we do. All right, diagnosing of disorders. So, Brad, why don't you talk about kind of the fundamentals of this and why Sure. that's important?
Sure. So, tree identification. So, when you look at a tree species in our area, a lot of certain things happen to certain species. So, if you can identify the tree species, you can identify a lot of their key issues. For example, if you see an ash tree, you know that the emerald ash borer is a threat to it. If you see a maple tree that's a little bit yellow, it's a little chlorotic. There's a lot of different tree species in our area, but if you can identify them, they have similar problems throughout them. So that's kind of a good way to start, is identifying the tree. What it's, baseline is, what is normal, what the tree should look like, and what it actually does look like on your property. And you can tell if it's got issues or not. So
yeah, I would certainly agree with that. And I think the big takeaway is to be observant of your trees and understand what is normal. Should a tree be, we get calls with people concerned about bark peeling off their trees. It turns out that they might have an exclamation London plane tree, which is a variety of sycamore, and that's perfectly normal for that to happen. So the more you understand your trees, the more you can find out and see what is out of the ordinary. So for example, like this maple tree in this picture here, is it a premature leaf fall color because the tree is stressed, or is it happening during normal fall color season? And it could be a perfectly normal thing, but if that is changing color in July, that's not normal. That's too early. So that is a sign of some sort of stress. So the sooner you can see those things, the better off your trees will be, because you can catch issues early with that. Which leads us right into the spiral of decline, the whole concept of catching things early. So overall, a tree over its period of its health, it will be in good health. And then you can start seeing the thinning canopy getting worse and worse. So when you observe your trees properly, you can see when things are out of the ordinary, catch them early. call us, or maybe it's just adding water or something that you can do at home, but you can definitely have a certified arborist like us come out and look things over, so that you can stop the spiral of decline at some point. If you wait too late, it's very hard and costly to correct some things. And the success of treating a tree and keeping it healthy really diminishes over time. So that's really the key takeaway with that. Brad, why don't you take this one?
Sure. A lot of different factors going into keeping your tree healthy. Watering, make sure they have the proper nutrients. A lot of times in our urban forest, the soils aren't very good, so they lack nutrients. So fertilizing on an annual basis really helps with that. Sometimes we plant more exotic species that, no one else has this kind of tree. And sometimes those trees take a little more care than others. That's kind of, some of the main issues with keeping your tree healthy. Prevention too. A lot of times, a little bit of fertilizing in the springtime will make that thing look pretty good all year round and or all season long, and reduce that early leaf drop.
It's definitely something that you want to think about the fundamentals of keeping your trees healthy. So, like Brad mentioned, watering.
Pruning.
Gas exchange is another big thing. People don't think about the root system, but trees need oxygen to breathe. And so, when you have a soil that's compacted, there's less ability for that gas exchange for the root system. So, compacted soils, they push on the pores in the soil, less airspace, more stressed roots. So if you have you avoid compaction and you have a nice aerated soil, you're going to have healthier roots. Brad mentioned the essential elements. Those, we could have nutrient deficiencies in trees. We have situations where we have higher pH levels, which make it harder, especially in the Milwaukee area. Our soils are just at about 7.5 pH, which makes them a little more alkaline, and then it's harder for trees to pull up nutrients out of the soil, those essential elements. So there's things we do to correct those things. And then obviously, physical harm to trees. I think of street trees, and they're pruned up quite high because garbage trucks and city buses need to get under them. But even then, limbs can get banged in. A lot of times people have the Amazon driver or a UPS truck come in the driveway and they hit limbs. Those can have problems. Or another big physical damage we see is lawnmowers and string trimmers, where people are bumping around the trunk of the tree, or even surface roots getting hit. Those can all be big things to cause problems for trees. Now, we have a number of different types of disorders that we have in trees, and they're grouped by various things. We have bacterias, viruses, fungal issues, insects, and then abiotics. And Brad, can you talk about a kind of like bacterial disease we might see?
There's wilts that are in the vascular system of the tree. Pretty hard.
And
That's a problem if you
like
have that.
fire blight,
Fire blight, yep.
What species do we see that fire blight on?
Pear trees, we see quite a bit. Crab apple trees are the main two, I would say.
Apple trees. And that's, we'll cover it fire blight because we see that seems to be on the rise.
It does.
What does that look like if someone's looking at their tree to
So
see if they
there's,
have?
well, there's a couple. There's on the branch can have like a little black area, like a scabby appearance to it. That branch probably isn't long for this world. Pruning is usually required to take that back to a different stem further down.
Fire blight. It looks like it sounds. So the leaves cling on the twig. They have like a scorched look and wilted.
The shepherd's crook, you can have it on on the flowers. That is also another version.
And then you have those kind of sunken dark spots on the trunk that look like they were burnt almost. So that's why it's got that name, fire blight. And that's really the big bacterial one that we see a lot of. But you know, there's other ones that are more nuanced that you know generally aren't a big issue in our landscapes. Viral is next. There's not a lot with viruses. There's some viruses are very difficult to treat. They're somewhat poorly misunderstood as far as how to diagnose virus things. There's one in particular that we do see. It's called ash yellows. It happens on ash trees. It kind of shows like a general decline in the tree. You know, we had issues with ash trees before emerald ash borer, and you know they called it ash decline, or they called it ash yellows, which was the virus. Since emerald ash borer has come into vogue, there's been you know a lot less emphasis on ash decline because we're just seeing so much of it from the emerald ash borer. But fungal, you know, fungal is our next type of disorder. Brad, why don't you talk about some of those, you know, issues with funguses? I think that's a big one, right?
It's kind of I would say it's our main one that we see in our area. Spruce trees, Colorado blue spruce trees have Rhizospira needle cast. Our pine trees have a couple, Dothostroma and Diplodia. You know,
Yeah, and
the
we're
apple scab. We'll get into all that, but that's probably the main one in our area. Years of fungal infection will really start to decline, start that spiral of decline on your tree.
yeah, how do like in general, how are fungal diseases spread and
Through spores and then raindrops. Not breaking up properly can leave a lot of those spores behind, and then when it rains, it they splash around and spread throughout the tree. So that's why we like to get our fungal applications on early in the season. Fungicides typically don't fix any disease. They prevent it. So those new leaves that come out, we want to get protected at you know early stage in the spring. They do wear off, so that's why we recommend multiple applications during you know the infection period
sure. So
of certain
if
diseases.
you're spraying late in the season when the disease is already present, it's not really
Yeah,
going to
the
do
die
much.
is kind of cast there.
Sure. Insects, we do a lot of treatments for insects. We have a number of tools we do for insect treatments. I can think of, you know, trunk injections that we actually drill small holes around the base of the tree and pump in an insecticide solution that works through the vascular highway of the tree to get throughout the entire tree. We do have sprays. We do, right? Some of those are foliar based, where we're going to spray the foliage. Others are targeted for the trunk of the tree.
Soil injected, so it takes it up and spreads it throughout its living tissue. So when insects feed on it, on that tree, they have insecticide. They chew on insecticide. So.
Sure, and that's, you know, the systemics and the trunk, the systemic soil treatments and those trunk injections are nice because there's not that environmental exposure,
Yep, that's
right? You're
really good.
not spraying and getting things, you know, in the environment that way. And abiotics, you want to cover abiotics?
Sure. Yeah, there's quite a bit of abiotic factors in our area.
Why don't we start with what abiotic is?
It's something in it's not any of the ones listed before. It's in the environment. Something that's
Sure. Yeah, and they're non-living. So all those other types of disorders are living organisms causing these things. And abiotic is a physical issue for a tree that's could be weather, right? Or compaction of the soil. So you know, abiotic might be cold damage. If we have a really cold winter, and like we've had that in the past with polar vortex, where we've had, you know, the temperature rises up in the day and then it drastically cools at night, or there's big temperature fluctuations that can cause damage to trees. We have cell walls that burst and cause issues. We've seen browning of yew bushes and things, and it all kind of happens. Usually that kind of stuff happens at the end of winter when you have the temperature fluctuations.
Those evergreens tend to dry out and
Yeah.
desiccate.
Salt damage, that's another example of an abiotic.
Sure.
You know, when you lay a lot of salt down, that penetrates into the soil and essentially it sucks the water away from the root system. So you have salt toxicity because of that. And that can happen in the ground, you know, from the salt leaching into the ground around the tree, or it could be direct spray, like when the plow truck drives down the highway and and sprays that salt spray onto arborvitae bushes that are used as a perimeter next to the roadway. I know arborvitaes are very sensitive to salt damage, so that's another example of that. All right, well, now we're getting into the big, diseases here. We're going to be a little more specific. Brad, you know just about anything you can think of about apple scab. I'll let you start this off.
Yeah, so apple scab is very common in our area. It happens on pretty much all of the crab apple trees that we have. There's a bunch of different varieties. There are quite a bit of resistant varieties, but that doesn't mean they're still not going to get it, unfortunately.
They might get a smaller amount.
Yes, yep. So with this, we like to, like I said earlier, get an application of fungicide on the tree when these leaves are just emerging. That protects that new growth for, the infection period. We like to get another application on a little bit later, about a month later. The fungicide typically degrades with weather over time. Rain, sunlight degrades it and becomes less effective while there's still infection going on. Not only fungicides, but other things to do to prevent this is, pruning, make sure there's good airflow moving through the tree. You can obviously fertilize. There's growth regulators that help with that, make the cell walls a little thicker and a little less prone to damage from this disease.
Yeah, leaves are thicker, it's harder for the fungal spores to penetrate the leaf surface.
Yep. I mean, they'll still be there. It'll just be better. A little less visible damage.
As I like to say, it curbs the effects of the disease, and sometimes that's all you need. And it's interesting. There are resistant varieties, but generally, what we see is over time, some of the resistance can wear off. On a tree. So some plants that, 20 years ago were planted and they were disease resistant, scab can leave its mark on those trees. And especially when you have those wet years too.
Yep.
So
wet and cool is ripe for fungus.
That's right. All right, the next one is rust disease. So we've seen a lot of rust disease recently. Last year, in particular, there was a lot of rust. What are you thinking here?
Similar to scab, it's just a different type of disease. It is harder to control than scab. Scab's pretty, pretty easy to control. This seems to, we're not after perfection with rust applications. Because it's quite hard to control.
Yeah, and really bad rust years.
Yeah,
it'll start off as spots like you see on this hawthorn in the slide, but over it will just they will just grow and multiply to the point where in middle of summer the leaves are completely yellow or brown and falling off, and the trees.
So yeah, if we saw a tree like this late in summer, be kind of okay and happy with this kind of control. The leaf still has a bunch of surface area to photosynthesize and create energy for the tree. If it's totally brown and off the tree or, before this point, then it's not able to create energy. So that tree starts to decline at that point.
Yeah, and for both apple scab and rust, we now do have these organic products that we're using, that we're able to use too. So if you, live in an area of, where drift could be an issue if you're really close to a neighbor's property or something like that. These organic alternatives are going to be nice to be able to think about using. That's cool. And the growth regulators as well, they will work on with rust.
Same thing with that thicker cell wall. And just overall tree health.
And these organics we're using, these are, they're accredited essentially by the by OMRI, right? Can you explain listed. What that is?
Yeah, it's OMRI listed products. It's basically, if you go to the supermarket and buy an organic apple, those apples are still treated with fungicide and insecticide in some cases, and they're listed or they're the chemicals that are applied to them are approved by OMRI,
which is the Organic Materials Review Institute.
Correct.
Yep. It's the leading authority for organic.
So they have a bunch of listed products that you can use and still have organic products.
Yeah, that's great. And then here's another photo of Russ. This is the alternate host, yep. Right? Where's the
juniper and cedars? Yep. So you this when you see this isn't a super big concern. You know, to fix it on the cedar, but it just shows that it's in the area and your hawthorns are going to be under heavy pressure from rust.
Yeah, so they start off on the juniper or cedar plants as these alien-like spores, and then those burst and spread out, and then they affect the hawthorn. So the damage, they don't really affect the health of the cedars, but they are going
to,
they can over time really become an issue on the hawthorns, or even apple trees or crab apples that get rust. Okay, this next one, this is a big one. We do a lot of treatments for this. Can you explain what we're seeing here, Brad?
Yes, so this is Rhizospira needlepast. So in the, if you can look at the picture there, the one that's most severely damaged, second from the right, that's years of decline and infection. The ones on the other side of that tree are still have it. And if they aren't protected, will look like that really thin one shortly. So with this, it takes a little bit of time, you know, a couple years to get that tree looking good again. I don't know if you're going to ever get those bottom branches back, but you'll be able to protect the others and the rest of that tree. When you spray the new needles are protected. So evergreens, obviously they hold their needles, but they drop the interior needles. So it takes several years of that new growth, healthy growth, to actually look like the tree's doing better. It's Rhizospira needlecast. It's very, very prevalent in our area.
Yeah, we see mostly on Colorado blue spruce. It can affect some of the white spruce trees as well. It looks like it's, you know, it works from the bottom up on a tree, and it works from the inside out. So what you're left with are just little, you know, all the interior needles start to decline and fall off, and you're left with just a little tufts of live branches on the end. And then when we spray, we're protecting the new growth. So after repeated years of spraying, you're getting bushier growth on the ends. But unfortunately, you know, what's dead on an evergreen tree is not coming back, even if we're spraying it. So you know, we can protect what's there, and we can improve the tree over time, like Brad mentioned, to respectability, and prevent you from having to cut down your spruce tree. And we do a lot of these treatments.
We do. Yeah. It's pretty fairly easy one to control, but like I said, it takes a little bit of time to kind of reverse it
to see results.
If you're down that road where it's just really thin.
Yeah, and then here's another example. You can see that that purplish red,
yes,
older growth. It's working its way up to the tips there. Okay, this next one. These next two slides are going to be about Austrian pines. So yep. Can you explain these? There's two, and they both start with D. It's hard and confusing to a lot of people.
Sure. Diplodia affects the new buds of Austrian pine trees and other pine trees. But it affects that new growth, where you can see that on the right hand side, that the tip of that branch is just cooked. It's not gonna make it. It affects the tips. That's right, Diplodia tip blight. It is affecting the tip of the branch, so that new growth gets damaged.
And same other things with pruning off things, increasing airflow and sunlight in the tree with pruning is a good thing to do.
All of these, if it, you know, disease and fungus likes cool, wet environments. And if it's the tree's too compact together where it's dark and cool and will hold moisture, it will likely to have, it's good disease conditions.
Yeah. And, you know, we have a lot of Austrian pines in the landscape. A lot of diseases that go along with it.
Yep.
So there's three main, well, there's two diseases and one insect that we see. Yep. But you can see this picture here where you see a lot of that tip blight.
Yep. That's probably a couple, you know, several years of infection.
Now, this next one is Dostroma needle blight. Affects the same type of tree, the Austrian pine. Can you explain this one, the difference a little bit?
Sure. Yeah, this is, once the bud of the new growth has emerged and it starts to expand, the needle, each needle gets a little, spot on it. It basically chokes the needle and kills the tip of it, of that actual needle. So you can see here, there's green on the needle or leaf, but it basically kills the and declines the outside of it. So it's not able to photosynthesize that portion of the needle. And eventually that whole thing will likely turn brown if it's that infected.
Yeah, one way I can always tell the difference is with the Dostroma, between Diplodia and Dostroma is that Dostroma has a stark transition between the brown necrotic tissue and the green healthy stuff. Here's another example of that Dostroma.
If you go back, you can kind of see that the tips of that, the new growth is nice and green, but it's infected. Those spores are still present and will likely expand to that new green tip.
Sure. Okay, elm disease. This is interesting. Our picture here is of ash trees, however, but we should have vetted that a little closer. But elm disease, is Dutch elm disease, American elm trees. It's been with us since the 50s. Many of the trees in the Milwaukee area in the 70s and 80s were cut down because of elm disease or Dutch elm disease. There's still Dutch elm disease, though. There's still elm trees around. They're a native tree. They seed themselves in. They grow. It kind of can be a weedy tree. So we see them growing in the behind garages and in back alleys.
Some still nice legacy ones too.
And there still are some nice legacy elm trees too. So some of our city streets, there's a handful of them left in different places. But if you do have an elm, there is a treatment option that we have. It's a preventive. Can you explain that?
Yeah, it's a macro injection of a fungicide that basically gets injected every 3 years, and it protects elm trees from Dutch elm disease. Similarly to, I guess, this kind of picture with the ash trees, it's a different type of injection, a macro injection where it's much more, it's a larger volume. And then on the ash trees, we use micro injections of insecticide that protects it from emerald ash borer.
So a much lower concentration of the product in the elm
Yep,
trees.
it's still as effective though. It works well. Preventing Dutch elm disease.
It's really amazing when you're doing these treatments, or if you're watching the technician do the treatment. We typically do these Dutch elm treatments on in the midsummer when the trees are transpiring a lot, meaning they're pulling water up from the root system, and they pull a tremendous amount of water up when it's a sunny day. And so some of these big trees, we're putting in 150 gallons of water, and their tree is pulling it up and can do it in like an hour. And it's amazing to see that, you're pumping it into the transpiration network of the tree, and it's just sucking the water right up to the to into the crown of the tree and pulling that chemical, that fungicide in there with it. So then it's blocking the movement of the fungus if the fungus gets established in the tree.
It's just another one of those insect systemic products that goes throughout the canopy. So,
It's the first time I did one. I was just amazed at how fast the tree pulls the water up. It was really a sight to see. Here's another example. Early on with Dutch elm disease, you'll see it'll look like wilting. Typically, it'll affect like one branch and kind of work through that
flaking.
branch. It doesn't generally happen uniformly or over the entire tree canopy. You'll see sporadic limbs that where we see that, and it's caused by an insect too. So an insect is a host for the fungus. So the elm bark beetle moves from tree to tree, and it gets the fungal spores on its feet as it's moving and feeding. It feeds on small 1 to 2 year old twigs on elm trees, and that's how the trees can get infected.
It's a vector for the disease.
Yes, it's a vector for the disease. So if you catch it early, you can prune out the branch I mean, that's what sanitation pruning is. And often, if you're pruning it during the growing season, you put wound paint on there to protect it so that it doesn't attract the insect. One of the reasons we don't prune elm trees in the growing season, or try not to, is because those fresh pruning cuts actually can be an attraction to the beetle. That's why we like to prune the elm trees and oak trees, for that matter, in the wintertime.
Yep.
There's the that's the bark beetle. That's the elm bark beetle crawling across your screen right there. Oak wilt is acts very similar to Dutch elm disease. Can you explain a little bit about this one?
We don't see as much of this. It is around, but we also do trunk injections to prevent this as well.
Yeah, it's a different. It's a different treatment. It's every 2 years. It's much more prevalent in like Lake Country and Waukesha County. We don't really have it too much in Milwaukee County. Can be a big killer on red oak trees. It moves much quicker through red oak trees, where the red oak will die in 1 or 2 years. Where with white oak trees, the white oaks have those rounded lobes on the ends of the leaves, and the red oaks have the pointy ends. But on the white oaks, it can become a chronic situation where it has it, the tree can kind of live with it for a number of years. It'll kind of slowly eat away at the tree. But like Brad said, we have the trunk injection option. Root grafts are a problem with, especially with the oak trees, because when the roots are connected, they fuse together from one tree to another, the disease can spread through those root systems. So if you have a stand of oak trees, even if you do the treatment, the disease can still pass through the tree through root systems. So a lot of times you'll actually do like trenching. People will trench around the tree to cut off any of those roots so that there's a physical barrier. The roots are literally cut between the two trees so they can't infect each other. So that can get pretty elaborate. So protecting and keeping oak wilt out of a stand of oaks is an important thing to do. And like we talked about in the beginning of this, be observant of your trees. Look for these things early, and if you can catch things early, it's a whole lot easier. And that's what the beetle looks like that feeds on the oak trees. Oh, one thing I did forget to mention too, and is that if you do have questions, put them in the chat, please. We'll be trying to answer these throughout the conversation. We're taping this ahead of time. So if you are already asking your questions, great. Keep it up. Okay, bronze birch borer. This is a big one. Why don't you explain this one?
Sure, it's very similar to emerald ash borer. It affects birch trees. You can kind of see in the picture there, it'll go after a stem. So if you see, your tree's looking pretty good for the most part, but one large section, or even maybe a small section, is declining severely, you likely have bronze birch borer that's killing off that section of the tree. This we like to do a soil insecticide treatment to get that insecticide into the tree for prevention. If it's we also offer a 2-year treatment that's a little more for larger birch trees. It's a little more effective if and more it's a little more effective,
Especially if you're seeing signs of the insect
then
already, you
then
definitely are going to
yes
use the trunk injection.
yeah, it's more of like a curative, and the soil insecticide is a preventative.
The old trunk injection packs a heavier punch,
It does.
right?
It does. And it's not always necessary, with that you're kind of it's maybe overkill on some.
But it's the number one killer in birch trees. Pretty much every paper birch tree that we see that's in decline is going to be due to the bronze birch borer. So the important things too is keep your tree healthy, keep it from being stressed. Birch trees like a lot of water. They like a shaded root system. So planting them in groups where they can shade each other's roots is very helpful. Or having a nice bed of mulch around the base of the tree. If it's just in a lawn setting, the lawn can actually heat up in the summer, the heat of the summer, and stress the root system, making it more susceptible to bronze birch borer. So this is probably, it's really important with birch trees to keep them in that environment, that favorable growing environment as well. So that's an important concept. And that's what those holes look like, those exit holes. Those are the D-shaped holes.
If you see that, you've already had, larvae feeding on living tissue, and the adult has emerged.
So that's a
that's a bad
that's pretty far along
yep.
the cycle then.
yep
So it'll be hard early on to see notice those holes. They'll be higher up in the smaller branches and things like that. But by the time you get to a main stem like that, a lot of the damage is there, and it might be too late.
And
At
it's that round-headed board, just like emerald ash borer. We kind of see the round head. That's why it's a D shape. The underside's flat, and the crown of the head is circular.
Yeah, so pruning too. We do prune out, and pruning out the damaged tissue is important too. So prune and treat. Right, this slides us right into that emerald ash borer, same family of insects.
Yep.
I don't know how much we need to cover with this. We've been having emerald ash borer for a long time,
Yep.
right?
Yep. If you can see the difference, I'm sure a lot of you have seen neighbors' trees that are dead, that are ash trees, and other neighbors that aren't, they're still living. So the ones that are living are treated, and the ones that are dead are haven't been treated and have been fed on, like underneath the bark here on this picture here.
Yeah, we've been dealing with emerald ash borer for over 10 years. I know it was first found in Michigan in the early 2000s, got into Chicago area, came actually the first case in Wisconsin was in Newberg, got right on the border of Ozaukee and Washington County. Fun fact, I guess, is Hoppe Tree Service was the first company to find it in the Milwaukee area in Oak Creek. I can't remember what year that was, but we were doing some work, and one of our arborists found a dead ash tree, and it looked and saw those D-shaped holes. So it called we called the Department of Agriculture, Trade, and Consumer Protection, and this was in a vast kind of like natural area, and they found literally that hundreds of trees were infected from that area, and that's when we knew we had a big issue in southeast Wisconsin with emerald ash borer. But those treatments work. The treatments have been very effective. They're over 95% effective if you're doing a trunk injection. So for those of you that are doing it and you wonder if it's going to save your tree, yes. Yes, it has been doing a wonderful job of doing that. Japanese beetles, we see these seasonally in the summer. Can you explain this one?
It's got kind of the life cycle here. They grub in
Here.
They're grub stage in your lawn and your neighbor's lawn and throughout the neighborhood, and then they hatch and they feed on, was this a linden tree or I'm
Yeah,
not
that looks like
sure
a linden,
what,
or was a
cool
linden.
cool looking linden. So yeah, they kind of feed on the top sunny parts of trees and shrubs, roses,
Birches.
birch. Yeah, linden are kind of the main ones that they go after, but they go after others. They're large. They take large bites. They're large, very easy to identify. They do superficial damage, but and they're fairly hard to control. They do. We can control them, but they have to feed to get knocked down.
Sure.
So it's like, oh, they're still present, but
You can
they're
lower the
tricky one.
numbers. You
Yeah,
know,
it's, you're still gonna get feeding. It's kind of a tricky one that, on this situation, want to follow up with fertilizing to kind of make up for some of that lost energy production from that defoliation.
they'll wear a tree out over the course
Yeah.
of years. You're
Yeah.
not going to lose a tree in 1 year of heavy beetle damage
Yeah.
unless the tree was Really stressed to begin with. The thing that, one of the reasons I hate these suckers so much is they feed in both their life cycles. When they're grubs, they're chewing on the roots, weakening trees. And then as they hatch, a lot of our insect pests will only feed on a tree and damage a tree during one of its life cycles. Well, not the Japanese beetle, right? They're feeding it as an adult on the tree. They're feeding on the roots. But we can knock down the population and lessen the damage. And that's really probably the takeaway with that one. Okay, now we're circling back to Austrian pine trees again.
Cinnamon
When
pine.
does it end with these Austrian pines?
They got three things going after them, really. I think we got another slide that's maybe a little bit better than this one. That shows the pitch masses. So Zimmerman pine moth
Coming right up, Brad.
coming right up.
I'll get
I
that
think,
slide. There it is.
yep, right there. So you can see that they hatch and then they go feed on the new tips of your Austrian pine or Scots pine, other pine trees as well. They also cause damage inside the trunk there as well.
Yeah, that's a real good diagnostic slide. If you see those resin pitch masses around the whorl of branches at the base, that's a sign of Zimmerman pine moth. So they hatch there, and then they come out to the tips of the tree. And another, there's Austrian pines that have all three of these
Yeah.
diseases going on. So we'll have, a common treatment protocol we might have for an Austrian pine would be an early season Zimmerman pine moth treatment. That's usually like in April, following up with the fungus treatments for, either Diplodia or Dendrostoma. Now, we're not going to expect you guys to remember the names or spell the names of those diseases. That's why you have arborists like us to help you with that. And that's the pine moth in its adult stage.
It's moving.
It's moving on us. All right, viburnum leaf beetle. We see a lot of this. This can be very destructive. What are you seeing with this, Brad?
Yep. This seems it fairly new. I mean, what, past five, six
Six
years, something
years
like
it's
that?
come into the area. It's an invasive insect, but it came with a bang.
Yep. It affects. There's a lot of different viburnum species. It's to me, I don't know if this is from this is just what I've seen. It seems like it goes after those arrowwoods and the cranberries, where they seem to have a little bit thinner leaf. Like a Korean spice has a thicker leaf, and it
Like more of a
takes.
leathery
Yeah,
type leaf, so
they do get fed on, but they don't really ever end up looking like that too much, where it's totally defoliated. So with this, we suggest a horticultural spray, or if you're noticing them when they're at this point, to actually spray them, like when they're at this stage, that will actually come back. Sometimes that's that season. So they're pretty resilient, but they do also obviously kill the tree after prolonged feeding.
yeah, one, it's interesting. I've seen what look like healthy arrowwood viburnums get chewed up really bad and die and not come back, which is usually
Sure.
unheard of with these insects. A lot of times trees are going to be able to tolerate, trees or shrubs will tolerate some feeding one year and come back the next year, using their stored energy reserves. But this insect can be tenacious on it. And the cranberry, the arrowwoods and the cranberries are the most susceptible. Now that the cranberry bush is also called the high bush cranberry, it's our native viburnum that we see in our woods and things like that. So they're really nice to have, and the
Sure.
birds love them. So we like to, do these, protect these bushes when we can. They're really common in the landscape. They multi-stems, they grow well. Landscapers have been putting them in for many years. So
It's pretty easy to control too. Just a contact spray, and if you let them go, like you said, I mean, I have seen them where the arrowheads have died. They're totally defoliated. It's like total defoliation. So they really go after those plants.
There's another look there. This is more of a glancing blow here. You don't
Yeah.
see as much of the skeletonization, but if you look closely at some of those leaves, you can see, damage looks like Japanese beetle.
Yeah, but skeletonization is
Yeah,
similar.
similar type of feeding, but it's a different insect. That's a bad case right there. So some of those aren't coming back probably.
Yeah,
So
it's too bad. It's a nice established hedge. It's going to be hard to replace some of that.
yeah, and that picture's not in the fall. That's probably in July right
Yeah,
there, and
those
you can
leaves look,
see.
everything else looks pretty green.
Yep. Okay, carpenter ants. These are interesting. We get a lot of calls about carpenter ants in the summertime, and people get real concerned about it. What's your philosophy? So first, I'll share mine after we hear
Okay, like
yours.
so first, I'm on the side of that they don't feed on living tissue. They're feeding on dead, already dead tissue of the tree. So to me, they're not a problem.
Okay,
That's short and
well,
sweet.
I'm pretty close to that. My what I'd like to tell people is kind of like Aaron Rodgers said years ago, just relax. Carpenter ants are so common. We see them all the time. Big trees, big old trees most likely are going to have carpenter ants at some point. And like you said, Brad, they feed on the dead tissue. So they actually, the cellulose, the structural cells of the tree, the structural cell walls are not damaged by the carpenter ants unless it's really far gone in the infestation. So you're not going to have strength loss with most carpenter ant activities. So we still recommend controlling them because over time with just repeated feeding like that,
Sure.
it will weaken the tree, but it's nothing to get alarmed about. Trees can cope with carpenter ants for a long, long time. Be mindful. You look for the frass. You can see the frass on the bottom of
Sawdust,
the
basically.
sawdust, essentially what that is. So those are signs of carpenter ants. Look for activity. Ant killer. We don't treat for carpenter ants. That's another.
We can, but I mean, you go to the hardware store and you're better off
Yeah, so
doing it.
usually you can find products at a home and garden center, and we usually recommend people use a granular product that they'll take back into the colony to get rid of carpenter ants.
I mean, I guess the one thing to add maybe is that it is maybe a sign, like if you don't know that there's a lot of, a big decay pocket in your tree and you're seeing that, that shows you that there's a big decay pocket.
That's
So there's, if there might be time to take some weight off of a big branch over your roof or something like that, it might indicate there's time for further inspection if you didn't know that there was a big pocket of the client already.
That's I'm glad you brought that up because carpenter ants are going to go to decayed areas of the tree. So there's something there to begin with that they're looking for. So that's a sign. Just likewise in your house, if you have carpenter ants in your home, it's because there's some area of decayed or softened wood already. So that's a sign of something else. Okay, Magnolia scale. This is one that's can be real persistent. Can you explain like maybe what we see, how to find out if you have Magnolia scale?
A lot of times people realize they have it when they see on the bottom left that sooty mold. It's real obvious. It's like it drops on your walkway, it drops on the plants underneath, and turns everything black. But what the real problem is the scale. The scale is feeding on the tree, with its mouth parts. It's a little bit difficult to control, but it is controllable with a series of applications. That sooty mold is kind of just it's secretions from the feeding, basically. And it attracts ants and it attracts bees. So
And
it can be
it'll
kind of a
weaken.
problem
Yeah,
now.
it'll weaken the health. The leaves are looking pale and anemic on the tree. They're actually like it's like they're sucking the lifeblood right out of it.
That's how they feed is with a sucking mouth part. It
Yeah.
goes in like a needle into the branch and sucks out nutrients and causes damage. So this one's a pretty tricky one to control, but we use growing degree days to get a real targeted application on there when they're the most susceptible. It's a handful of times a year
Yeah,
that we do
timing
that.
is really important with this one. So, yeah, look for that sooty mold. And then if you see the sooty mold, the little white bumps on the 2-year-old not far behind. So, you can look for that as well. Okay, stem girdling roots. So, this is interesting. I always like to talk about the telephone pole effect.
Yeah, it looks pretty straight into the ground instead of a tapered.
Correct, correct. So when you've been an arborist for a long enough time, you can walk around and you can figure out stem girdling roots on a tree pretty quickly. Biggest tree we see it on is Norway maple trees. And the reason that happens is they have an inherent thing in their genes to that they roots tend to wrap around the trunk. And it doesn't help that we at nurseries, in way they grow in containers and fall in burlap plants. These roots kind of are almost encouraged to do that. So what happens is these trees are planted, and their roots are already starting to circle around the base of the tree, and then they are left like that when they're planted. So if that's a lot of this can be fixed at the time of planting if you reorientate those roots so they're not circling around each other. But I want to go back to the telephone pole thing so that they look like a telephone pole in the ground. They don't have that wide flaring out root system. That's a sign of a healthy root system. So Brad, why what is happening underground when we see the telephone effect?
Likely, likely there's a root encircling part or all of that trunk, choking it off. So basically, what you notice is the canopy starting to decline. And like, oh, what's going on with the canopy? It's not really the canopy that's the problem. It's the root is choking that portion of the tree and choking all the circulation off.
Constricting the flow of
Exactly.
water and nutrients.
Exactly. So yeah, we use what an air tool to air knife to move that soil away without damaging any of the root system, and then remove as necessary. Sometimes it's too late. Sometimes it's this tree looks like it's kind of young yet and savable.
Yeah, it's very interesting. We have some pretty cool tools to deal with this. We're blowing compressed air around away from the base of the tree. We're inspecting it. We're removing the offending root or portions of it. Like you said, Brad, it can be a spectrum. Some trees can be severely girdled all the way around. Sometimes it's just a glancing blow. And that's a judgment we'll look at. There's situations where we see propensity for stem girdling roots, but the tree it just kind of deflected, and we choose not to cut the limb because or the stem because we want to do no harm. And sometimes if you're cutting it, you're not going to solve the issue. It could make things only worse. So sometimes it might just stunt the growth of the tree. The tree might not grow as fast, but otherwise look healthy. In that case, we might not try to take some of these invasive methods to cut the roots. But other times we'll look at it and say, well, if we do nothing, this tree is going to die.
You better
And
do something.
it's going to die in 3 years from now. So let's get in here and let's cut the root off. It might be something we're going to cut part of the root 1 year and come back 3 years later and take some more off because we don't want to injure the tree too severely.
Without looking at the canopy, there's also a possibility that this is just planted too deep.
Yeah, and
You
that's
know,
the other
if
thing
you
too.
take it down and there's no girdling roots, you just kind of change the grade a little bit and it should be in good shape.
Trees that are planted too deeply, they also can be more prone to girdling roots because those roots want to grow, they want to rise up to where closer to the soil
Yeah, well,
surface.
there's no other roots. There's moisture there. There's nutrients there that
There's
they're
better
searching for.
porosity in
Yep.
the soil, so there's more air exchange, that gas exchange we talked about earlier. Here's another example. When you blow the air away, that's what you can see. That tree is really getting constricted. And I found it's really rewarding sometimes when you're doing these root removals where you actually cut part of the root and it just pops off because there was all this pressure in there. And you can almost like feel the tree starting to breathe again. It's just like, wow, I just really accomplished something to save this tree's life.
Yep. So yeah, the roots, they can grow. I guess like you can't see where I'm pointing, but the roots can grow and graft together. But those roots don't graft and grow together on the stem. It's like it's different tissue. So it chokes it. It doesn't graft, it chokes it. While it can grow together and graft and not cause problems when the roots are crossing over each other. So it's a little bit different.
That's a profound statement. I didn't think of it that way, but you're absolutely
Yeah,
right.
it's different. So it otherwise it would just graft to the tree and it'd be fine, but it's
Yeah.
not. It chokes it. This is a
They
different.
can't grow to and fuse together like
Yep.
that.
So when you take that off, you'll actually see a bowed section where the root was.
And they can heal.
Yeah, for
We've come
sure.
back years later
For
and we've
sure.
had some really good successes in saving
This is
trees.
a good one to get early, though.
Yeah, we have our own air compressor tool. It's very easy for us to do this. We bring our compressor and our wand, and it speeds up the process having those tools.
Add a bunch of organic matter to the top of it and
Yep. All right, so oil compaction. We've talked about this before in the very beginning. The trees need air spaces. They need a, aerated soil to grow their best. In this picture, you have a honey locust tree. They're a very tough tree. There's a reason they're planted so often in communities is because they can deal with really bad soil and compacted soil. But the real idea here is to not have yourself give trees enough root space and not to compact the soil around it. And if the soil does become compacted, we can do aeration of the soil using that same compressor and wand that we talked about on the last slide. Do you have anything you want to add with this?
Yeah, I mean, it's just, the clay soils tend to really, in our area, the clay soils that we have tend to really compact, especially if it's a high foot traffic area. You put in a new patio or a shed or something with this construction going back and forth over a section of the root area. It'd be good to aerate that out a little bit, create a little more porous soil.
Sure. Okay. And water is, too much or too little water can be an issue. What do you recommend people do with water?
Call plumber. I don't know. Yeah, I mean, if you're looking, I don't know if they're trying to planting a tree here or what the situation is. It just shows that the water table right there is quite high. Right tree, right place. If that's or move the spot where
Yeah.
you're going to plant that, if that's what's going on there.
If you have too much water, it becomes an anaerobic
Yeah, where
situation.
they
Those roots
suffocate.
aren't able to get the oxygen exchange they need for respiration, and the tree's going to suffer. Some species are able to cope with, higher levels of this anaerobic situation. So some trees can tolerate some wetness. No tree can constantly be in
Sure.
water, but some can handle it much better than others for periods of time. Same thing with dryness. If you don't have enough water, the permanent wilting point is reached, and the tree's not able to capture any more of the water out. Soils are different too, so it's really based on your soil. Like clay soils are going to hold the water longer. It's also going to be the clay particles in the soil really adhere to the water molecule tighter though too, so they can make it harder for the tree to kind of yank that water away from the clay.
It goes for nutrients too.
That's right. That's
It
right.
holds onto those and it's not available.
So a lot of people ask, how much should they water their trees? We get asked all
Not
the
that
time.
much.
When we do a lot of tree planting. We're happy to plant trees for people, and we leave behind an information guide about watering, and it talks about, about 1 inch of moisture per week. But the reality really is to look at the soil. Is the soil dry and crumbly, or is it moist? You want to keep the soil moist. You don't want it soaking wet all the time, and you don't want it to be dry and crumbly. So what we ask people to do, a lot of times people have mulch over the soil. Peel back a little bit of that mulch. Feel that soil in your fingers. Is it moist? Is it clumpy a little bit, or is it just all dry and crumbly? If it's dry and crumbly, it needs to be watered. So, and we like a good deep watering is a nice way to do it too, where you really get that water saturated down into the root zone of the tree, and it also that helps the roots grow deeper into the tree. If you're doing kind of lots of frequent surface waterings, those roots are going to stay up at that upper area. They're going to be expecting that water constantly. So really, a slow trickle of the hose is a really good way to water because it really gets that water going deep down, and then you move your hose around maybe three or four different spots around the tree. That would be my advice. Chlorosis. This is our last slide here. Chlorosis is a sign of a nutrient deficiency. This is another one of these abiotic situations. We talked about this a little bit with our pH level of our soil makes it difficult for trees to pull the iron out of the ground. And the reality is there's a lot of iron there, but the pH is doesn't allow the tree to grab it. So what do we do, Brad? What are some things that we do for this?
So there's a couple of things. There's kind of a band-aid fix. I would say a 3 year trunk injection
A
of
short term.
yeah, it's a band, it's 3 years isn't super short, but it's it pretty much immediately reverses the chlorosis. We like to do it in the fall because it has knocked the leaves off the tree.
It shocks the
It
leaves
does,
with that amount of
but
iron.
yeah,
So it's a
it's
direct
more.
trunk injection of iron into the tree.
Yep, and that dose lasts for 3 years. And during those 3 years, I would like to recommend, fertilizing, get to the root cause, so to speak, getting that soil profile with either, get some aerate it with the air spade tool and fertilize it.
With acidifying agents, right?
That too, yes. Yep. Macro and micronutrients, beneficial bacteria is all in our fertilizer blend that improves the soil profile. You could, I guess, in theory, just if you're unable to do that, just every 3 years inject it, which you could do. We
Sure,
do.
sure.
In
So
some
really,
situation, it makes sense.
so we're trying, there's two things we're trying to do. We're trying to make the root system stronger, and we're trying
Gonna
to
lower the pH level, make it easier for the tree to hold that minimal water. And we, and to immediately, to reverse that, that's not creating much energy for the tree.
Sure. All right. Well, that wraps up the slideshow. Just want to finish up by saying thank you, everyone. You guys are a great audience. I hope you learned a few things about the big insects and diseases that we see and the common stuff we're dealing with. Understanding trees and tree health is not an easy thing. It takes years of explanation and years of practice and expertise. So we just encourage you to just be one with your trees. Get out in your yard, look at your trees, see things that are abnormal. We're always there to help too, right? You can contact us. We have certified arborists. It might be myself or Brad that comes out, but it could be someone else from our team. They have a lot of knowledge. We've been doing this for many years, so we can really help you and guide you along the way and come up with custom programs, right, Brad?
If we like to be targeted, instead of just, we'll treat your trees. We like to be targeted.
Yeah,
That's
we're
what we're doing. So we keep the beneficials. We're ethical with what we do. We like to, try to innovate with this organic, start this organic program. So continue to learn and improve our services so your trees look better.
All right. Well, thank you guys. Our next webinar is going to be in about a month. It's going to be about tree planting and the top trees for 2023. So that'll be an exciting one. So stay tuned for that. You can sign up on our website, and have a great evening. Thank you.